Hello, everyone. Welcome to another episode of Visual Studio Toolbox. I'm your host, Leslie Richardson.
And I'm your host, Robert Green.
And we are joined today once again by Phil Gipixie.
Hey, everyone.
So we're continuing our series on automated testing. In previous episodes, we discussed what automated testing is, why it's important, and we also started doing a dive into XUnit in order to kickstart your automated testing. So last episode, we specifically discussed theories and an intro to assertions, and now we're going to continue that conversation on assertions, right?
Yeah, there's not enough time to cover all the assertions out there, right? We kind of bounced around some of them. So I'm going to hit a couple other high-level assertions. Mm-hmm. And the first one I'm going to talk about are object assertions, right? And so when we're doing comparisons, if something is a value type, a number, right, equal and same really has the same definition, right? Because mm-hmm. they're pointing to the same place. When you're talking about object types or things that are on the heap, equal and same are different, right? So same would be it's pointing to the same object on the heap. Equal, you'd have to have an equality comparer to get into it. And let me just demonstrate that so that it makes sense. So I have a person record, and just for edification, there's my person record. I also have a person class, right? And yes, I know it's actually a record class, but the records give you that value semantics, right? Mm-hmm. So let's do a comparison, right? We can check for nullability. That's not too exciting. We already covered nullability pretty much with the value types. But then we are looking for same. And same means for both records and classes that those values, the variables that we're checking are pointing to the same object,
okay.
Right? They're exactly the same,
okay?
Right? So here
so
we have-
So it doesn't mean two objects that have the same values.
Correct.
Okay.
Right? So if we look at, I probably should have organized this better. So P1 is a person, P2 is another instance of the person, has the same values, but two different objects.
Right.
Okay? So when we do our check, we are asserting they are not the same. Okay? Because they are two different objects. Same with the two different records, record one and record two, right? Again, mm-hmm. both John Doe, but two different instances, so they're not the same. But if we look at the record type, we can assert that record one and record two are equal. Because what a record brings to the table is value type semantics. So it will actually do that comparison of the properties of all the values to see if they're equal for us. But we can only do that, right? So we only do that with records out of the box. So this example here, and nobody at home can see what I'm pointing at. So the example I have highlighted is showing that they're still not equal. They're not the same and they're not equal. But we can get those value semantics by adding in a equality comparer, right? And so if you look at what an equality comparer is, this is a standard object, you know, it's from the base class libraries. What I have written here is it derives from iEquality comparer of type person, but then I determine what makes it equal. So I'm just comparing the properties that go through, right? So it's not a deep quality comparer, like if person had another reference type like address, well, I'd have to have an equality comparer for address as well. So that's an important distinction when you're testing, because equal does not mean the same.
So what's a use case for when you're testing equality to two objects that are actually pointing at the same thing versus having the same values?
So this becomes really important when we're setting up mocks. So when you're setting up an expectation that something happened and you're calling a method with certain parameters, mm-hmm. right? It's also looking at that equality. So if you have a method that says, the controller method calls repo.get and is passing in the number 5. and you say in your MOQ, and we'll get to it, you know, did it execute the method get passing in a five? Right. Well, five is five, mm-hmm. right? They're equal and the same. But if it's passing in a person object who has an ID of five, right? We're actually passing in a person and not mm-hmm. the ID. And so that mock will fail because they're not the same instance.
Okay.
Right? So I know it's different than what we're talking about here, but it's related. Right? So understanding that difference between equality and sameness becomes very important when we're setting up expectations with mocks, but also just in testing, right? You are passing in something by ref. You expect to get that same reference back.
Okay.
Right? Mm-hmm. But if you have a return value, like let's say you're passing in a person and you're returning a person and you're expecting it to be the same instance, right? This is where you could test that.
Okay.
Right? Or if you don't care about the instance, you want to make sure the values are the same. Again, this is where you could test that.
Okay. Got it.
So it's not frequently used, but when it is used, with a lot of the trainings I did in my prior career, a lot of people stumbled on not understanding the difference between same and equal. So I just wanted to point that out.
Got it.
Collections, there's a ton of them. I'm not gonna go through all of them because there's only a few that I use in reality. Certainly empty. And this is more efficient than doing assert.equal0 list.count. Right, because list.count, it has to iterate. It's like the difference between list.any versus list.count is greater than one, mm-hmm. right? So it's a little more efficient. There's also an assert.single, which is only one element in this item. Okay, and then we can also do all or any. Well, the any is not all.
What's the single that takes in a second parameter that's like right below the one you highlighted? It was like list comma or list one.
This
comma
one, this
zero.
One here.
No, the first one in that second section.
Here.
Yeah.
Let me remember because I don't use this that much. So I'm not getting it in IntelliSense. Oh, the value expected to be in the collection. So it's a single value, and I want it to be zero.
Okay.
Sorry, I never use that in real life. When I was going through the source code to make sure I had everything documented, I added that in there. So thank you for calling that out. And then this is the same thing, except it's actually taking an expression.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
So we're going to calculate based what that value should be.
Cool.
All right, from a dictionary, we have the same type of thing, does not contain and contain. So again, nothing terribly exciting, earth-shattering there, but something that might be necessary. Like I'm passing this thing in and I want to make sure that all the students are in there. Mm-hmm. You know, does the collection contain all of these? Fluent gets a little more interesting. As you kind of learned as we've gone through this, right? If you can do it one way with XUnit, you can do it 20 ways with the Fluent assumptions. So this is where we can build on it. So it should not be empty. It should have four items in it. And the items should be in order, at least two of them, right? Two and five, right? And mm-hmm. so we're checking two and five. So those are in order. And the items must be assignable to int. Now this is an int array already.
Yeah.
So that's kind of meaningless. But if it was an object array, mm-hmm. right, or a straight up list as opposed to a generic list, mm-hmm. this is where you can make sure all the things getting back. I'm pretty sure this is a carryover to before we truly had generics.
Okay. That's interesting. So it's kind of similar to like converting a string of the number of two, mm-hmm. like, and then calling like two int.
Yeah. Because if it was a string of two, it's assignable to an int because mm-hmm. it's int.parse. Would that work or is it the other way? No, that's a great, great point because I don't remember if it's an implicit or explicit conversion mm-hmm. that's going on. Usually is assignable to means that the base class supports it. So, okay, I just answered my own question as I talk through it. Passing in, if this was a string of two, this really shouldn't work, right? If these were all strings.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because whereas I can do an explicit conversion through int.parse, I can't do an implicit. It's not assignable to. So typically assignable. Terrible example because it's a bunch of numbers, but let's say I had a collection of person type and or a collection of employee, and mm-hmm. we want to make sure they're all assignable to person, right? So they all derive from person, or they all implement the iPerson interface.
Oh.
That's typically where you use that.
Mm-hmm. So like for inheritance and things?
For inheritance and things.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, and that's, I didn't show that in the object operations because there is also a whole section where you can say this class is assignable to this other one.
Mm-hmm.
I just haven't found a whole lot of use for that in real life. This, I think, is much more important. This I threw in there because I could, and it's demo code.
Makes sense.
Then there's equivalent and non-equivalent. So equivalent, and now we're getting into math. Regardless of order, do these match? Right? And that's the equivalency. And not equivalent is regardless of order, they don't match because there's a 3 and there's a 1.
Mm-hmm.
So if order doesn't matter, then you can do this. So if you're using N or X unit to test this, you'd have to do a sort first and then do a compare,
mm-hmm.
an item comparison. And then there's, as you would expect, a whole bunch of more that, as I'm scrolling through, we're not going to talk about all these because it keeps on going. And I just want to get to the end to make sure. Yeah, so those are all different Fluent assertions you can do on collection. So if there's something you need to test in the collection, Fluent will have it.
Yeah.
So last thing I want to talk about with XUnit is asserting exceptions get thrown, right? So we're going to talk more about this. Again, this is a teaser for the MOQ, the mocking episode, where it's really how we handle it normally. But sometimes you want to verify that your code throws an exception. So let's say you've got a divide function,
mm-hmm.
right? And it's, you're dividing by 0 can happen if they pass in the wrong values, right? So now I'm going to assert dot throws divide by 0 exception when I call the divide, passing in a 1 and a 0.
Okay.
Right? Not the best example, but conceptually that puts us in the frame of mind. Right? So there's this concept that our action throws any exception, and then it's generic. So we are going to throw any of this type or anything derived from it.
Mm-hmm.
So obviously, if I'm using exception, anything under system.exception would work. Right? But I can be more specific. But I can also pass in a specific instance of an exception
mm-hmm.
into the method. And I say, hey, it's going to throw any exception. But by the way, throw this one, right? And then it's, you know, we can check that they are the same instance. Now, again, because we're working on a concrete class, there's almost no way for us to actually test that it's the same instance. Because what we're checking here is really our exception handling, right? You know, when we were talking about this show, Robert, I know you had asked the question of when would you use this? And really what I'm thinking is, hey, we had an exception happen in real life, right? And we know because we checked the logs and however we did that. And so I'm going to write a test where I'm throwing the exception.
Mm-hmm.
So I know that I'm throwing the exception. So now I've recreated the situation that we had in prod. I know we are where we are. Now I can start diagnosing why I didn't handle it, you know, how I can improve the error handling and things like that.
Okay.
Right. So this is not as commonly used. Well, let me put it this way. I don't use this that much, this format that much. But again, it's important to have in your back pocket and say, hey, if you're going to do something, right, and we're going to throw this exception, and maybe this isn't even your system under test. This is part of your arrangement, right? I am arranging that this method on this other class is going to mm-hmm. throw this exception when it's called. And now my system under test is using this instance, right? Because we're talking about instance method tests here, not mock tests, right? So it's the actual method itself getting called and throwing the exception.
Got it.
Right? There's a couple different formats. We saw this one where we say throws any, right? Anything that derives from that. We also have assert, if I could type. Surprise, Visual Studio isn't jumping in again. We have assert.throws. And this says, you're going to throw this exact exception type. Nothing derived, right? But this exact type. And those are two big ones, really. But let's go down to the triple A syntax, which some people like this better. It's not that I struggle with it because I think it's readable. I struggle with it because it doesn't flow off my fingers when I'm typing. And so what we're doing is we're actually recording that this exception will happen, right? And it's just some people like this format better where you're recording this exception will happen as opposed to saying, I am asserting that this exception is going to happen. Just a different format, right?
Okay.
Here's the fluent. Yeah, I forgot what the triple A there in the bottom. And I think this is easier to read, and I think it's easier to write. So if we look at this method right here, this is the same as throws, right, in the XUnit framework. But we're saying that this action should throw exactly this type of exception.
Okay.
And it's going to have this message. Now, we can expand that because some of the exceptions that are in the system framework, or even your custom exceptions, can have additional properties through the event args or through the, well, just the properties on the exception. So now we can say the parameter name equals this,
okay,
right? So we can get very, very refined on what we're checking. And then we can also check the absence of a throwing, which I'll be honest, I don't know that I've ever written that in real life because I've got tests around my methods and it shouldn't be throwing because otherwise those tests would fail because an exception would make a failed test.
Right.
So that is, one other thing that you can do with Fluent. And again, this is, I want to show you these things because, you know, I don't want to judge everybody's development needs on what my needs are. But again, I've never used this, but I can say, hey, I have a nested exception.
Okay.
So this is very important. You know what? This actually does make sense. If you're doing something like with EF Core, where you're going to have your exception, but then there's an inner exception. And this is saying, hey, this inner exception is what you're asserting.
Yep.
That really wraps it up. There's great documentation out there for XUnit and the Fluent assumptions. I know we just scratched the surface. We tried to hit, you know, a mile wide. We went about 10 feet deep. So hopefully this has piqued your interest in diving deeper into XUnit and Fluent assumptions.
Yeah.
Assertions.
Definitely makes me want to use Fluent.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm really a fan of Fluent. That. I like Fluent a lot. It's my kind of syntax. So what's up next?
So next we're going to talk about a little different style of testing with BDD. So behavior-driven development or behavior-driven design, depending on how you like it. It's flipping it around. And I'll give you a little teaser. If you want to build a ship that can do the Kessel run in 7 parsecs, right, that's the outside. This is what our end goal is. But with TDD, I can only build the cargo cabin, right, or an engine or a gun or the targeting system, right? So we have to build at the micro level on our way out, but we always think at the macro level on the way in. And BDD helps us actually document that thought process to get down to the micro level.
Cool, sweet. So focusing on like big picture, kind of narrowing your way in. Awesome. Right. Looking forward to that.
Yeah.
Sweet. So stay tuned for BDD. And until next time, happy coding.
See ya.